go ahead and begin this morning. In answer to your question, yes, we will begin on time. A preacher's ears hears all, right? All right. More seriously, it is our privilege to welcome the family and friends that are here in memory of Myron Stevens. Family, I want you to know that our church has been praying for you since we got the news, and we will not stop praying for you. I assure you of our prayers collectively as a church and personally from me and my wife as well, and our sincerest condolences. But we're here to celebrate the life of Myron and to remember things and to honor our God, who was also his God. And so that's what we're here to do today. Everyone is invited at the end to the meal that we have in the fellowship hall. And we've got tables kind of spread out, so should be socially distancing acceptable, or whatever you want to call it. So we'll be glad to have you join us for that. Let's open this morning in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you that you love us. In spite of our failures, in spite of anything that we can do, you love us, Father, and you care about us. And Lord, you are the God of all comfort. And so, Lord, we pray that you would comfort the family today. May this service not just remember Myron, but may it honor you as well, for you were Myron's God as well. We thank you for the opportunity we have to have this memorial service and for those that have come. And again, we ask your blessing upon it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you will take your hymnals, please, and turn to number 549. Hymn number 549. I love this song because anytime somebody passes that is a Christian, the first face they get to see is their Savior. And I long to see Jesus' face when I pass over, and I know Myron did. So let's stand together and sing number 549. Face to face with Christ, my Savior. Face to face, what will it be? When with rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ, who died for me. Face to face I shall behold. And then the last. What rejoicing in his presence when our banished grief and pain, when the crooked ways are strengthened and the dark things shall be saved. Face to face I shall be. Christ who loves me so. Face to face I shall behold him We've asked Pastor Waters to join us today. Pastor Waters is former pastor of Myron's, and so he's going to come at this time and read the obituary. You do have a copy of it in your bulletin on the inside front page of your bulletin if you want to follow along.
Myron Heeman Stevens, age 75, entered into the Lord's presence on August the 5th, 2020, in Yuma, Arizona. Born in Farmington, Maine, he was one of four sons born to the late Theron and Carolyn Stevens. Myron was born into God's family at the age of 43 on February the 6th, 1976, in his home in New Paltz, New York, where his pastor led him to the Lord in Myron's living room. He loved to paint and retired as a self-employed painter. Myron is survived by his wife, Carol Stevens, two brothers, Philip and of Blairfield, Georgia, and Caleb Stevens of Jay, Maine, five children, Cheryl Stevens, Myron Stevens Jr., Rita Stevens, Timothy Stevens Riley, and Jackie Stevens for Roseco. Five grandchildren, Jonathan Trent Springer, Jamin Tyler Springer, Tammy Riley, Hayden Riley, and Kayla Riley, as well as many other family and friends. In addition to his parents, Myron was preceded in death by his older brother, and I think that's not correct.
No.
It is not his older brother. That would be his younger brother. Next. Yeah, all right. Eldon Stevens and a great-grandson, Dominique Springer. The family is enjoying your presence today and helping them celebrate the life of Myron Stevens. Thank you for coming.
Joyce Landis. Bob and Joyce are two of the missionaries that we support as a church. He has a ministry, MTT Ministries. He just got back, in fact, from spending the greatest part of the summer ministering out in the Mormon West. And he takes teams out and across the world, really. And how many teams have you taken now, total? Do you know?
76.
I knew it was a lot. And anyway, they when I started putting this together, I knew that Joyce did an awesome job of playing the piano, and I love hearing them sing, and so I asked them to join us today. And I want to thank them for taking the time to come today and ministering to us in that way. Thank you very much. All right, well, we heard about Myron's family, and it is our privilege to have his brother, younger brother, Philip, with us today, and his lovely wife. And I'll let you introduce her, if you will. But would you come and you have a few words to say this morning? Come on.
A couple words.
If you could come up here, that'd be
sure.
Appreciated.
Sure. Now, this is my, just a minute.
My name's Philip Stevens. I'm Myron's brother. And this is my wife, Beverly Foster Stevens. We've been married for 49 years, just the other day on the 21st.
Uh-huh.
And we've only had one argument. It's just been continuous. Just one continuous argument. Look, I want to thank all of you from the bottom of my heart, from Carol's heart, I'm very sure, from Jackie, from the whole family. I have a younger brother, Caleb Stevens, up in Jay, Maine, and he's sorry he can't be here today. He has COPD, can't travel right now. But we had talked on the phone, and I also wanted to thank the pastor, Pastor Brian, for putting this all together, for writing everything up for us. It takes a lot of work to do something like this. I don't know where to start with Myron. I'm only going to talk about good things. Right?
Yes.
But no. Myron is a special guy. I knew that when he was born. Myron was the firstborn in our family during 1945, during the war years. He was a wartime, Second World War baby. And he was born, and he was just a very inquisitive young man, I remember that. He was always digging around. I don't know, how many here are farmers? Any farmers? There's some farmers, okay. Well, one thing that he loved to do, when he was about 4 years old, I remember, my mother told me, he heard the baling machine coming to bale the hay, and he would always try to follow it. I had an uncle, B.D. Butts, who would hay through the community, and every time Myron could get out there, he'd follow that haying machine all day long. And we were just young fellows. There were four of us in the family. My mother and father, my father was a woodsman, worked in the woods an awful lot. My mother done washings in town. I'm sure a lot of you understand that, doing washings to make a few extra dollars. And so it was kind of kids always say, it was rough, but nah, you stop and think about it. We had three nice meals every day and a nice warm place to stay, and we had a lot of friends and things like that up in Stratton, Maine. Can you imagine that in January? January. And so there are a couple of things. As Myron went through school, he was a painter. I'm glad somebody brought that up, because I remember when he was in eighth grade, He went to Stratton High School in Stratton, Maine, and he painted the piano. He put a beautiful, beautiful finish on that piano. Like, everyone in school would walk by it and say, and then the teacher said, "I can't help it. You know, I gotta give the guy an A." He's gonna do such a good job with the piano. It was beautiful, great job. So I'm bringing out some of the things last night. I got thinking about this Myron. He was an instigator. He'd get me into trouble. One time we went down to my aunt's house. She got tired of us, and she sent us home. She said, "Look, you take these 12 donuts." Well, when's the last time you had a donut, a real plain donut? She said, "Take those donuts and go home." And on the way home, it was about a half a mile. Myron and I sat there, and we, you know, we got a little hungry. We just decided we'd eat those donuts. We ate them all, and we were pretty full, you know, and we didn't tell our mother about it. And so that was the kind of things that we got into. But I'll tell you, as he got older and everything, and he went out into the world, our paths didn't cross as much. He loved the farm. He loved working on the farm. He was older than himself. What I mean by that, when he was, you know, he was always thinking older than he really was, and all of that. And so it was just kind of a great time. I have some pictures that you can see. I remember one time we would hike with a pack on our backs up into these mountains when he was in the Boy Scouts. And he always would figure out a way to get somebody else to carry that not a sleeping bag, we had blankets. So he would figure out, "Hey, don't you want to carry this blanket for me? Don't you want to?" And there was a lot of comedy with Myron. And he was also serious, very serious. Once he made up his mind he was going to do something, it was his way, and that was how it is. That was just how it was. And so as I went along last night thinking about Myron and some of the things he's done, I don't want to take up the whole day. I got a not whole hour thing here that I'd like to talk about. No, but there is a little something that I came across last night that my brother Eldon, is 2 years younger than I am, so that would make him 4 years younger than Myron. And at his, and he passed away in November 2nd, 1996. And he had struggles with alcohol poisoning, and that's run in my family for years. I've battled it. But anyway, as I read through my brother's obituary last night, I came across this, and I'm sure the pastor's read this many times, and all of you are acquainted with it. I just like to refresh our memories a little. The name of it is Footprints. You've heard it, Footprints. There might be one here that hasn't heard it or something. And I had not, I'd heard it, but it was a long time ago. The author is unknown. And it says here, "One night a man had a dream. He dreamed he was walking along the beach with the Lord. Across the sky flashed scenes from his life. For each scene he noticed two sets of footprints in the sand. One belonging to him and the other to the Lord. When the last scene of his life flashed before him, he looked back at the footprints in the sand. He noticed that many times along the path of his life, there was only one set of footprints. He also noticed that it happened at the very lowest and saddest times in his life. This really bothered him, and he questioned the Lord about it. "Lord, you said that once I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I have noticed that during the most troublesome times in my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why, when I needed you the most, you would leave me." The Lord replied, "My son, my precious child, I love you, and I would never leave you. During your times of trial and suffering, when you see only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you." And that really got me. I said, "Yeah, you're right, Lord." And isn't that true today? And I was trying to think if there's anything else. Did I mention anything to you, Bev, that I was going to say other than that? So as I looked around at the pictures that were here, brought back a lot of nice memories. Thank you from the bottom of my heart for coming today and being here. And Myron's pictures there are some there that are, they really, really bring back some great memories, don't they? And so with that, I'd like to just say, Lord, I just know that, when we get off the path, the Lord steers us back. And I just know that there's going to be a place for all of us in heaven. And it's just going to be such a great time. Now, Myron today is at peace.
Amen.
He's at peace with all of everything. It's all over now. He's with Eldon. He's with my mother, Carolyn, who, by the way, was a great fly fisher lady. She could fly fish. And with Theron, we used to call my father, my neighbors used to call my father Theron the Blue Heron. And they're all together up there, and I know that I'm going to stay as long as I possibly can on earth and do God's work if I possibly can. And with that, I just want to thank you so much. God bless you all. In Jesus' name, amen. I'll take all the papers that are here, even the money. Oh, excuse me.
Take your hymnals once again. Number 517. You may remain seated this time. 517. Sing the first and the last, please. 517.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have him than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that my wandering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
All right, thank you. I have asked Pastor Waters to come, and again, he's a former pastor of Myron's. I did not have the pleasure of knowing him personally. Carol tells me I've met him, and she can tell you that story. Back in my public safety days when I worked at Bob Jones on public safety, I showed up at their trailer one night, is what I'm told. I don't remember it, but but Pastor did know him well, and so I've asked him to come and say a few words about what he remembers.
First time I met Myron was at Ingalls grocery store. I was coming out to check out, and there was this short, gray-haired, by the way, short is not a sin. Myron and I were seeing eye to eye, so we were about the same size. So I came out of the checkout, and I started to leave the store, and there's this short, fairly plump, nothing wrong with that either. Right? Gray-haired man standing there, and he smiled this little funny smile. You know, it's just a little short, tiny, tight smile. And I looked at him, and he looked at me, and he handed me a gospel tract. You know, I don't know about this, but Myron will probably go to heaven with a gospel tract in his hand. He loved to give out gospel tracts. So I turned the track over and looked and said where the church came from, and I found out where he was going to church, and I said, just keep up the good work, Myron. I didn't know his name at that time, but I said, just keep up the good work. And he smiled that same little smile again, and off I walked, and he was ready to give a track out to somebody else. Oftentimes he'd go visiting with us at church, and sometimes we have like Operation Saturation, and he would be a participant in that. He loved to visit. And he loved to tell people about Jesus, and he loved to give out tracts. So that's my fond remembrance of him. Evangelism was in his mode of thinking. Another thing, when I visited the home out at their very neat, clean, well-kept, manufactured home there in Greer, or Taylor maybe, I enjoyed going and visiting each time. Myron painted that thing, I declare, I couldn't believe it. Now, he's a painter. You knew he was, right? And he painted it light pink and maroon. Is that right? That's right, yeah. Light pink. And but I thought, now, this just won't work. But guess what? It looked good. It really did. And if you know anything about painting metal, that's not the easiest thing to do in the bright sunlight. But anyway, he did a great job on that. And I remember Carol and Jackie, and I remember Myron working in the yard, cutting the grass, planting all the different things they could plant, and just, you know, just good, hard-working people. Amen? And I enjoyed their fellowship so very much. He told me a story one time, and I wish I could have been there, but he tried to get me transported into this story. But he said in his own way, with that main brogue and caw and all that stuff. But anyway, he said one time he and somebody, I don't know who it was, decided just to up and go to California. You remember that?
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, he just up and took care, just went off. He and another guy just took off to California. And somewhere or another out there, he decided to come home and the other guy didn't. And so he said, I didn't have a whole lot, and said, I had to find me some shoes. And he said, the only shoes I could find was some size 12 or something tennis shoe. Now, he didn't wear size 12. I mean, 8 or 9 maybe, but he had these tennis shoes that were like the clowns would wear. And so here's Myron going across the desert, and he just laughed and giggled and said those feet was flap, flap, flap. So we had a good time talking about those things, and I was thinking about what all the memories. And you know, when we get to heaven, the Lord's going to say, you looked at certain spots of a life, but I looked at the whole picture. And we're going to be able to, with the Lord, get a proper perspective on the life that was lived on this earth. It's like those ladies that were looking at a botanical or garden one time. They were all blind, every one of them. And they were so excited to be with each other, but they were blind. They couldn't see the flowers, couldn't see the plants, couldn't see anything. And so they called, they saw this fella, or something, they didn't see him, but they knew this fella was there. I guess they must have had a helper. And said, come over here and take our picture. And he's thinking up here, what in the world do these blind ladies want a picture in this botanical garden? Why do they want a picture? They're not going to be able to see the plants. They're not going to be able to see the flowers. Can't see each other. What in the world do they want a picture for? So he left those beautiful gardens after he had seen everything about them and enjoyed it so much. But he couldn't get that thought out of his mind about those ladies wanting a picture. He said, what in the world do they want a picture for? And he couldn't get this thought into his heart. He didn't know that the blind ladies, when they finally split up and went their separate ways, that they would take that picture once it was developed in the days of that developing pictures. Once they got their pictures back, they would take them home to their loved ones, and they would say to their loved ones, tell us what's on the picture. And the loved ones would sit there and say, well, there's this plant and how it looks with the colors. And there's this person that you know so well. And this is how she looks. And they would sit there and just thrill about what they had experienced without sight. But now somebody with sight was telling them what it was like. So now they enjoyed their trip even more. We're going to get to heaven one day, and we're going to sit down with the Lord and with our loved ones. And he's going to say, your life went this way, this way, and this way. And you were seeing through a glass dimly, darkly. You didn't know. But this is exactly what God was doing in your life at that moment in time.
Amen.
So no matter where Myron went or where you and I go, up or down, right or left, good or bad, the Lord's going to show us what our life was all about. Amen? And it's going to be to the glory of God. Let me give you a verse and then I'll be done. This is in Psalms 50. And I encourage you to read that psalm, all of it, but I'll read just a couple of verses. Whoso offereth praise glorifieth me. And to him that ordereth his conversation aright will I show the salvation of God. There's a lot of things for us to complain about, and it seems like we're prone to do that. But here's what this verse says. Whoso offereth praise glorifieth me. That's what God said. We are here to glorify God.
Amen.
That's what we're here for. And Myron's life, with its ups and downs, ins and outs, good and bad, glorified God. That was God's plan. We may not see it, but God sees it. He sees the whole picture. It says in verse 15 of that same chapter, "And call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me." This may seem, as we look back and think about the life of Myron and miss him and the family will, and my heart goes out to Carol and Jackie and other family members, Philip and his wife. My heart goes out to you. I really mean that. I don't know what it's like to miss a loved one, except I had a little grandchild pass away at birth, and I know how that touched my heart deeply. I know about my mom and dad passing, and I know about a few others, but I haven't had a brother or sister, Philip, to die yet, to pass away. But I know this, that the Lord says, in the day of trouble, you call on me, and then I will be glorified. Amen. Yeah. So I'm calling on him today. We're all going to do that. Each of us going to call on him. So I want to comfort the family with the good memories that we have. And I want you to know something. You cannot comfort the old nature. Only the new nature can be comforted. Amen. When I'm speaking to an old nature, there's not going to be any comfort. But I'm speaking to your new nature in Christ Jesus. And the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. Oh, I pray that if there's one here that does not know that grace of God, that today will be the day that you have a new nature, so that you can understand the comfort of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Pastor Waters. Appreciate that. Again, I want to thank everybody that has participated in this service and helped me put this together. Somebody mentioned about that, and I couldn't have done it without all the information I got from Carol and Jackie and Philip here and others. So thank you for putting up with all my many phone calls and everything. Phil, I really, you disappointed me in that one story you told me. I just knew that you were going to say that when Myron got done painting the piano, it was pink and purple polka dots.
It was a very light pastel pink.
Yeah. Oh, it was a pink, okay. But it didn't have purple polka dots.
No, it was a burgundy, and he said it reminded me of
one of the punch. Aw, okay. Anyway, take your Bibles just briefly. I promise not to be long this morning, and my church people can stop laughing. But Proverbs, turn to 1 Thessalonians first. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. There are several go-to chapters when you're conducting a message or doing a message for a funeral, and of course 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Is one of those that's up on the top of the list as far as I'm concerned. I go to it often and have used it before in funerals. I am going to be in that passage. I'm going to read that passage, but we're not going to stay there this morning. But I do want to start there. But before I do that, I want to remind you what Psalm chapter 30, the last part of verse 5 says. And this is for the family. It says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning.
Amen.
And I know there is sorrow. I know there is sorrow in your heart at the loss of a loved one. I have lost my father. I've lost my next oldest brother. Not that long ago, my wife lost her mother, and I know what it is to sorrow at these times. But praise God, when the loved one knows the Lord, the Bible says we sorrow not as those that have no hope.
Right.
So that's what this passage talks about in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. So if you have turned there, if you will, follow me as I read verses 13 through 18. Of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Paul says to the Thessalonians, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so then them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that ye which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with the Lord, or with them in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. I see two things from this passage that I want to point out, and then we're going to look at a couple other passages as well this morning, some of which are in on the back of your bulletin if you want to look at them. First thing I want to point out is that the Bible does not say that we are not to sorrow. The Bible does not say we're not going to have sorrow. We do have sorrow. But we do not sorrow as those that have no hope. And the first thing I want to point out to you, folks, is that as believers, if you are naming the name of Christ, if you have given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, then you have hope. And that's what this passage tells us about. And that hope is even greater when the one that has passed also knows the Lord. Because we are going to see that loved one again. And again, that's very much what this passage is about. So believers have hope.
Amen.
In fact, if the loved one that has passed knows the Lord as his Savior, as Myron has given testimony to know, then it tells us that his body is actually going to raise first in the second coming of the Lord. It says he will not prevent. That means precede. Or we will not prevent. We're not going to precede those that have already gone on. They will actually precede us. See, in this time, the thought was you put the body in the ground. You know, that's hopelessness. And God says, no, that's hope. Because, yes, they will be raised again when Jesus comes back. So believers have hope. And verse 13 tells us. Verse 18 tells us that believers have help. It says there, wherefore comfort one another with these words. We have the help of each other. We are to comfort each other. And Carol and Jackie and Philip, I want you to know that our church is here. I am here to comfort anytime you need comfort, anytime you need encouragement. I'm glad to talk to you. Carol kept telling me yesterday, I call her about this or that or the other. And she said, I just feel so bad. You're spending so much time on this. I'm like, Carol, that's what I'm here for. And I meant that from the bottom of my heart, Carol.
I know you.
And Jackie, you too. And Philip, it's been a pleasure to get to know you the few times I've talked to you on the phone as well.
Yes.
And I'm glad you know the Lord. And
Amen.
I'm glad you have that hope that the rest of us can have. Praise God. So folks, there is hope, but there is help because we can comfort one another. But the greatest thing about that hope is that it's not just the comfort that we can give each other. Because the unsaved can try to comfort others. And they do. In a funeral, if you've ever been to a funeral when the majority of the people don't know the Lord and the one that passed doesn't know the Lord, there's a lot of attempts to comfort. But they cannot give the kind of comfort that we have,
right?
Because we not only have each other, we have our God.
Amen.
And he is indeed the God of all comfort.
That's right.
And so I want to remind you of two things about our God. First of all, he is a holy God. He is the holy God. In Isaiah 57:15, he says, for thus saith the high and lofty one. And if you look in your Bible, the word one is capitalized. It's talking about God. That inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. If you're here today and you name the name of Christ, you can have peace and you can have comfort because of the God that you serve.
Amen.
But you can only have that peace and you can only have that comfort if you are in obedience to that God.
Mm.
And if you are trusting him. Don't expect God to give you comfort if you aren't serving him. There is no comfort in not serving the Lord. This says that he is here to revive the spirit, who? Of the humble and the contrite. The man that or woman that is humble before his God, that admits that they're a sinner, that has accepted that God as his Savior, Jesus Christ as his Savior, and walks humbly before him. Humbly, yes, but walking. That implies the idea that they are being obedient to that holy God. You see, God is holy, and he has a right to demand that we be holy. In fact, the scripture says, be ye holy because I am holy. We are to live in a way that honors God. Now, none of us are perfect. Myron wasn't perfect. There's not a perfect person in this room.
Right.
If you're perfect, would you tell me your secret? Because I know I'm not. Okay? There isn't a perfect person in this room. But we can please God and we can be holy as we try to walk with Him in humility and in obedience to His word. So, believers have hope. Believers have help, the comfort of one another and the comfort of the God of all comfort. And believers have a holy God.
Amen.
And then last of all, I want you to understand that believers have access to healing peace. To healing peace. And in here, these are the verses that are on the back of your bulletin. But in Isaiah 26, 3 and 4, it says, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace,
amen,
whose mind is stayed on thee,
amen,
because he trusteth in thee. Trust ye in the Lord forever, for the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. We can have God's peace. In fact, this says perfect peace, and in the original language, that is actually the Hebrew word shalom, said twice. Shalom, shalom is what the Hebrew literally says in that passage. And anytime in Hebrew, in the Hebrew language, that a word or a phrase or a thought is repeated, it's always for emphasis. And when Isaiah says that thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, it's talking about the greatest peace that can be had. And folks, you do not, if you're a believer, you do not have an excuse not to have this peace. Because God has given it to you. God has made it available to you. And it is yours on two conditions. One, that you keep your mind stayed on him. And that word stayed means to lean on. Now, I can lean against the pulpit, you know, like this. And that's one kind of leaning. But I can stand back up on my own feet. This kind of leaning is that kind of leaning that supports something that if the support is removed, what is leaning on it falls. That's the kind of support that we need to trust in God for. If you get sad, if you have a time when you just feel defeated, and especially as you think about Myron's passing, and the Satan's going to attack you with his attacks of discouragement and his attacks of fear. But if you will lean on God,
amen,
he will give you that healing peace. Why? Because he is our protector. In Isaiah 41:10, that verse says, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God.
Amen.
I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. God, we need to trust in his power. He talks about him strengthening us. He can give us strength because he is strength.
Amen.
So he strengthens us. He surrounds us. He wraps those arms of love around us so that we never have a reason to be discouraged, to be fearful, or be defeated. And he supports us. Trust in God's power. And then in Hebrews 13, 5 and 6, it says, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have, for he saith, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. God is always with you. That I will never leave thee nor forsake thee is a promise that God had repeated over and over in the Old Testament. in Deuteronomy 31:6, in Joshua 1:5, in 1 Chronicles 28:20, and in other places in the Old Testament. How many times did God tell Joshua, don't be afraid, don't be dismayed, I'm with you? And he tells us the same thing. Our God is always there. He's always there for us. And so we can trust in God's presence. You see, you have access to God's healing peace because God is your protector, God is your power, and God is always present. And with those three things true about your God, you don't have to fear.
Right.
And you don't have to try to do this thing called life on your own. Because God is there for you. And God has promised you healing peace. Philippians 4:7 says, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Paul repeats basically the same thing to the Colossians when he says in Colossians 3:15, it says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called. What is the application, folks? We're here for a solemn and sorrowful occasion on the passing of Myron. And I know that there are tears. And I know that there is sadness. But you can have God's peace because he gives you hope. He gives you help. He is a holy God and gives you that healing peace. But in order for you to have that, you have to first know God so that you can learn to trust him. Sunday morning, Pastor Gatlin preached here for our homecoming service on the passage in Mark chapter 4 where Jesus was in the boat and a great storm came up and the disciples were fearful for their lives. And they said, Master, do you not know that we perish? The problem was they did not understand the person that was in the boat with them. And folks, in the middle of any sorrow or any circumstance you find yourself, God is in the boat with you. And if that God, that same God that can calm the storm, that same God that spoke the worlds into existence, that same God is with you. And he says, I will never leave you or forsake you.
Amen.
So he is there for you to give you that comfort that you need when you are sorrowing, when you're sad, when you're lonely. Whatever the emotion might be, your God is with you and can comfort you and can be your God. Amen. Trust him, folks. You need to, first of all, know that God, you need to know God so that you can learn to trust him. And then you need to obey God so that you can be in the right place that he can bless you with that peace. As I said before, Don't expect God to give you peace if you're not obeying his word. It won't happen. But if you're obedient, and it comes down to that song that we sing so often, trust and obey. For there is no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Amen.
So I hope that that's an encouragement to you, family. Again, I want to thank each of you. Philip, I believe you and your wife get the long distance award this morning. Thank you so much for coming all the way from Georgia to be here with us today. I know that that's a great encouragement to Jackie and to Carol. Thank you for doing that for them. And it's an honor to meet you today. It's an honor to have all of you here today. May God bless you and may God give you that peace that only comes from him. I've asked Pastor Waters to come and close us in prayer. And Pastor, would you also bless the food?
Sure.
So that when we get over there, we can eat.
Okay?
Okay? All right. And like I said, you all are invited to come over there. If you did not get to sign the guest book that's on the back there, please do so. I asked everybody to give your email address and your mailing address in case the family needs that or wants that to send off thank you notes or whatever, so that they have a way to do that. That's why I asked for that. But so please be sure that you do sign that guest book, and we'll give that to the family as of their memory, and also make sure you got a bulletin today. Again, thank you all. God bless you. Thank you, Pastor Waters.
Let's stand for prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ, the name that is above all names, the only name in which we can come to the throne of grace. And we thank you right now that we do have a throne of grace where we can obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And we need your mercy today because we're not perfect. But Lord, we sure are glad we can get your grace.
Amen.
Thank you for the grace of God. And I pray right now that each of us will receive the measure of grace for this hour. And I know that there is a special grace for this time of sorrow and the missing of our loved one and the missing of our friend, the missing of our brother in Christ. And I pray now that you would help Carol and Jackie and other family members, Philip and his wife, and all the family members back in Maine, all the extended family. I pray that you'd touch some heart afresh and anew with the gospel of Jesus Christ that Myron loved to tell about so well. And I pray once again that that gospel era will find a lodging place in some heart, and that some soul will come to Christ because of the passing of our dear loved one. And Lord, we're glad that we do not have to sorrow without hope. We've got hope. And I'm glad that Myron is with you. He's perfect. He's complete. He has no pain. He has no trouble. He has no confusion. He is with you in complete joy and perfection. We thank you for that great thought. Thank you for the great peace that we can have in knowing that our brother is with you. I pray now that you'd help those who may not know that they are born again and saved, that this will be a day that some person would come to know Christ as their personal Savior. And now, dear Lord, we thank you for the time that we will have fellowship one with another as brothers and sisters in Christ. And I pray that you'll bless the food that we're about to partake, and thank you for those that have prepared it. And I pray that you'll bless each one for having been here today and honoring the Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and also honoring our loved one and our friend, Myron Stevens. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I'm just trying to get this on film so that anybody that wants to see this can see this. All right, thank you. Sorry.